Are we live? Can you all hear me? Do you think this is working? Hello everybody. Could someone tell me in chat if this is working? I should be live right now, but I'm not too confident. And I also think there's a stream delay, so I have no clue what's going on really. I was desperately trying to get the chat on the screen, but it doesn't seem to be working right now. It's working, amazing. Hello everyone, and welcome to the stream. Today we will be reviewing your poison dart frog vivariums and some other vivariums, because I thought that would be a fun idea to do live on stream to get some kind of interaction and stuff going. We are a lot of viewers already, that's incredible. Thank you for coming here to watch me. Yeah, the chat on the screen is still not working, so your chat messages won't be in the video eventually, but I guess that's fine. Yeah, there is a delay, but if I remove the delay, the stream quality is going to be really bad, so I don't really care about doing that. So we will have to live with all of that. How good is the audio? I have tried it a bit before, but is it like acceptable? Not too much white noise or anything bad? I will have to wait 20 seconds for the response, but I guess that's fine. Let's see here. Other than that, I think we just go straight to today's the subject for today. Unless you are going to be screaming that the sound is really bad. It's all good. Amazing to hear. This is my microphone that I record all of my videos with. It's just sitting here. Very low budget. I would like to have something that could be like standing so I don't have to hold this, but it works, I suppose. So today we have 18 submissions of vivariums that we have to review live, which is going to take quite a while, but I think we're going to get through it eventually, hopefully. And you can also send in more vivariums during the stream. There is an email address in the description where you can send it. However, you will be last on the list, and it's going to like take me a while to actually like download images so I don't leak your email and everything like that. If you want to be featured, send it as soon as possible. Yeah, I know there is a bit of audio delay, but if I remove... You mean a delay in the audio that's behind the video, or just the whole stream is delayed? Because if the audio is behind the video, then we have a problem. If it's like not in sync with my mouth, but I think it's just the whole stream. Most likely. Otherwise, it's really stupid of OBS to not be working like that. Let's see here. Yeah, so I think we just head straight into the first vivarium. I have three different... It syncs with the video, perfect. Thank you. This is most likely going to be a YouTube video eventually, so let's hope everything goes well, and if this is appreciated, then we will most likely do this again at some point, I think. Yeah, I suppose it's time to get going. So let's see here if I can open up everything. So, we have the first vivarium right here, actually, and this should be working right now, I think. You can see it and everything, I'm pretty sure. So this vivarium came from... I have a message to this one that I'm going to read, and I'm going to read the message for all of these ones. Hello, my name is Christian, and I live in the States, and here are a few of my tanks. Nothing compared to yours, but I do enjoy them. First three picks attached house my four Phyllobates aurutaenia. I included a freshly planted pick and what it looks like now. Next two house my pair of Lygodactylus conraui, microgeckos. Next is a picture of my pair of Ranitomea uacarii gold-legged vivarium and a picture of one of them. And lastly is just a planted tank. So I forgot to mention that the first 5 submissions we have today were actually sent in like a year ago, because I was considering doing this same YouTube video back then. And never got around to it until now, so I'm reviewing these 5 vivariums now. Or, well, this guy sent multiple vivariums, but these same guys, and we will see where we... yeah, it should work. So, this is one of the pictures. I'm pretty sure this is the... Oh, shit, that's not what I meant to do. This is what I meant to do. So I'm pretty sure this is the tank that houses the Phyllobates aurantia, a really beautiful frog species similar to the Vitatus that I keep. I would love to keep them at some point, but I'm currently focusing a bit more on the thumbnails if I'm expanding my collection. And I'm not sure if this was the uacarii goldleg tank or if it was the microgeckos, but he seemed to have both of those. This will be significantly better on YouTube later with the editing than in the live stream, but this is also fun. So here's one of the Ranitomea uacarii. And this is one of the Lugodactylus conraui, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. And I think this is the same tank as before. This should also be one of them. And here are the beautiful Phyllobates aurantia. Really amazing frogs, in my opinion. Just have to check how it's all working. Yes, it seems fine. So this is the first... No. There was another picture, actually. So this is the first submission. I think this is a very solid vivarium. I think I'm mostly going to focus on this vivarium because it's like the biggest one, and he sent multiple ones, so I can't really speak about all of them. I usually do the same kind of background with just hygrolon and nothing else, and it's very effective, but it kind of also, it's a very quick approach, which is, you know, obviously understandable because I do the same thing. I also don't really like to put a lot of effort into my backgrounds, because that just takes up a lot of time. And when it grows in, it's really just fine to have anything like this. I'm not sure what this very fast growing plant in the middle is, but it's a nice one for sure. So yeah, this is the first vivarium. So what do we think about this one? I haven't actually seen any chat messages in like 2 minutes. Maybe that's just you being quiet, but I'm just a bit worried that so everything works. So if you want to just send something, that would be great. This will be edited out of the video, I think. I'm not sure if I'm going to rate all of them. I think I am, and I think this is a very solid one. For the frog's sake, there's definitely nothing to complain about or anything like that. Obviously it could be a slightly more, yeah, amazing. Thank you for the chat messages. Just had to double check because this is my first time being live, so I'm a bit, and yeah. So I think this is a very solid vivarium, maybe like 7 out of 10 or something if we're going to review it. So definitely a great plant selection, as you mentioned. One thing that I do have to comment on is this anthurium. I'm pretty sure it's like an anthurium crystallinum or something like that. These get really massive, and then you're sitting there with like 30 centimeter leaves that just take up so much space, and it's actually like really annoying because you can't really move the whole plant when it has like an established root system in the hygrolon and stuff, which is very annoying. So to me, it's just like depressing to keep these ones in small vivariums because they will just outgrow them and then be difficult to move. But for the frog's sake, it's absolutely nothing to complain about. And I'm pretty sure this tank is also like somewhat large, I think. Definitely great for the frogs with all of this dense planting, because they can just get away very deep inside of this tank if they want to. And I think basically the same can be said for this one. It's slightly smaller, but yeah, I think these tanks as a whole get like a 7 out of 10, a pretty good basis. Like obviously it could be a like different background and stuff like that, but there's absolutely nothing to complain about for the frog's sake. It's a really great tank. So that's the first review. I'm hoping not every single review is going Monolina species red. Yes, we had a comment about the plant species. I had no clue what this one was, but thank you for the detail. Hello, Marion Cool. Yes, I could review your vivarium if you send it to the Gmail address in the description, and it will be reviewed at the end of the stream. There will be like a technical break to download all the new images that haven't been sent in advance, but I will definitely review it. So, time for the next vivarium, I think. Let me see if I can bring that up. So this one was also sent in a long time ago. Not in a galaxy far, far away, but definitely a while ago. Let's see if I can find the text as well. So this is a very interesting one, I think, for a few reasons. I have checked all the vivariums briefly because I had to download the pictures. But I haven't really had a detailed look at all of them. So this is, it's not like I have a script or anything, as you might notice. So let me see. So this is the second vivarium. Obviously this is not the finished product. But this is one of the pictures from when it was being set up, and I'm going to read what he wrote. This is my current project. It's a converted wardrobe. The pics included are from when I first started building it. The unit is lined with UPVC underfoot damp proofing sheets, and it's fully automated using smart times from Sunoff, and it also has a fog system. I have no clue what half of this means. It's still growing in, and I've added more plants, mainly bromeliads. It will house an Amazon tree boa along with a few dart frogs when it's finished, so it's taken me just 12 months to get to a stage where I'm happy with it. Kind regards. So the Amazon tree boa and dart frog cohabitation is actually not as outrageous as most of you probably think at first. It's actually a fairly common combination to keep bigger arboreal snake species together with dart frogs, because the dart frogs are really tiny and they can't really do anything towards the snake species or towards the dart frogs. They don't see them as food at that size. So this has a good chance of working. However, I would be very careful about frog proofing this lamp. But as I said, this one was sent in about a year ago, so I think they have most likely figured that out by now. So this is one of the earliest setups. I keep doing that. Here is apparently a much newer picture of the same vivarium, but I didn't get a new overview shot. I only got like this overview shot and then some really close ones and some various ones throughout the building process, but it's very interesting to see, of course. I think that was the same picture again. I may have downloaded that one twice. It's a very interesting like technical build and stuff, but here you can see that the vivarium is fully planted, and it's I would like to see a picture from this state of the vivarium, of the whole vivarium, because I'm kind of missing that. So I think from what I can see, it's definitely looking pretty good. I think it's like a very impressive thing to successfully convert this wardrobe kind of thing to a dart frog vivarium. I would not be able to do that myself. So for that, I think it's also worthy of a 7. I think the planting is nothing too spectacular, but I would most likely have a different comment if I could actually see the whole finished product instead of just seeing this overview shot. I think these palms, I'm not sure about the English name, I only know it in Swedish. But I think this usually grow a bit too big, and I can't really say much, to be honest, because this is very early. So I think this also gets a 7. I think we're going to be handing out a lot of 7s today, because that's like the most average score, I suppose. Let's go on to the next one and let's see what we have. Give me a second here. So the third one, we have only two images, which I think by now we definitely appreciate, because that will be make everything that's going to make everything significantly easier. So this is the third enclosure. So let me find their message as well. If I can find it, here it is. Hello, this is my paludarium with 4 phyllobetes vitatus superspots. 2.2 ratio, that is 2 males and 2 females. Getting 20 or so eggs per week from them. So this is the setup, and this is a second picture. No, that's not a second picture. This is a second picture, where you can also see the water feature a bit more. So I think my main comment on this vivarium is that there's a lot of moss and very little leaf litter. It's not like dangerous to have a lot of moss and stuff like that. But I would most probably consider adding like a bit more leaf litter to half the ground, but it's definitely fine. I mean, if you're getting 20 eggs per week from them, then you're probably doing something correct. A lot of people, if you're from Dartfrog Facebook, will probably freak out about the water feature. I can say that Dartfrogs can swim. It is an issue in some tanks that it takes up a lot of their usable space, but in this case I definitely don't think that's an issue because they do have plenty of space left. So I'm not going to drag it down from that or anything. But personally, I would most likely remove a bit of the moss from the ground and try to get it up on the walls, if this was my tank. But aside from that, it's really beautiful, I think, and I hope it's doing well today. It probably is. This Rhesia hieroglyphica, I'm pretty sure, is most likely going to outgrow the vivarium. But I can't really complain about that because I just bought one for my most recent tank anyways myself. So yeah, I think they're so beautiful that it's worth it, but it's still something that can be a bit annoying. Hello to all the new people who are tuning into the stream. I did actually get one aquarium submissions, which I will show, but I'm probably not going to spend too much time talking about it because I don't know anything about aquariums. So you can send it in and I will have a look at it really quickly. But it's don't expect to get too much comments on it. Yeah, I think this tank looks really awesome. I think it's like an 8 out of 10 maybe. It's very simple but also very effective. I would kind of still like to drag it down a notch because of like the huge amount of moss on the ground, but it's a really nice tank. I just noticed one of the frogs are actually up here. I didn't see that one before. Yeah, 7.5 out of 10, I think, for this one. The ratings aren't anything too serious. It's really just something I mentioned for fun because that's kind of it's a good clickbait on YouTube and stuff. That's the main reason, I think. Let me see if I can find the next person here. This guy also sent 2 images, which is great. I think that's fantastic. This is actually a Swedish guy, which is also very fun. So I will have to translate the message and everything. Let's see here. Here we have it. So, wait, where did it go? Here it is. Okay. This is my first Dartfrog vivarium. It houses 4 Dendrobates auratus, and I'm assuming these are Dendrobates auratus Costa Rica or something. And the vivarium is 80 by 45 by 35 centimeters. No, that's still not how to switch pictures. This is how to switch pictures. Can fast mental dartfrogs eat Drosophila hydei flies? Yes, they definitely can. I currently only keep Melanogaster because it's a lot more convenient to culture. but it definitely works. Let me see, is my camera going to shut down in 20 seconds for you? I really don't hope so. I think it was just like the preview window. It should be fine. If the camera dies, then I will have to redo something. I don't know. Let's see what happens. So yes, fast mental dart. Oh, it said froglets. No, I would definitely doubt it. So fast mental dart frogs, for those of you who don't know the common names, because common names are really unnecessary. The fast mentals are Epipedobates anthonii, or tricolor, I don't know, but anthonii is the correct name in most cases in the hobby. I can't get my froglets to take even the melanogaster fruit flies when they get out of the water, so I have to feed them springtails or aphids. So I wouldn't trust them in eating hidey-eye flies right away. I just read the fast mental dart frogs at first. The adult ones definitely can. Anyways, here we have the vivarium once again. So here's the setup. That houses four of these Dendrobates auratus. I think it's a pretty good looking setup. I personally hate using old aquariums myself. I had one and it was extremely annoying to take care of, in my opinion. But I mean, if it works for you, then go ahead. I just thought it was very annoying personally. I do think the lid situation here is very interesting. It's kind of like mesh all over the top. So yeah, I'm not really sure what's going on with that. I feel like the... Oh wait, it's like... Are these like lids for plastic tubs? So you have like the lids here and the mesh for extra security, I suppose. I feel like this lid mechanism is very annoying to take care of, most likely. But the tank itself looks really good, I think. It's a very like simplistic tank, but it definitely does the job. So the melanogaster fruit flies are a bit more convenient to culture because exactly, they breed faster because the they get a new generation of flies in about 2 weeks, and the hidey eye take a bit more, maybe like 4 weeks or something, or 3.5 weeks, something like that. So there's less time for the cultures to start smelling bad, which I definitely appreciate. I also killed off my hidey eye cultures and I didn't bother getting any new ones. But yeah, I think this tank is very simple, but it definitely does the job. I mean, you have the plants, so the dart frogs can get a lot of coverage. And I think this is a great example of how you don't really need a background if you just overplant it, so there's a lot of foliage still for them. So I think I would give this one like a 6 or something. So definitely nothing to complain about for the frog's sake. Maybe the bottom is slightly wet, but I think there are dry areas as well. So yeah, 6 out of 10, great job. Let's see if I can find the next one. We're blazing through these ones really quickly. Number 5. Who was the 5th one to send them? I think that this is the last old one. Yes, this is the last old one. Okay, so we have a bit of a strange situation here, which is very fun, of course. I'll get into that. So this guy was the last one that sent their picture a year ago. Next one will be a more recent one. So this guy said, "Here are some pictures of my vivarium. It's my first and only, so it means a lot to me. It measures 48 by 18 by 18 inches. So far, its only inhabitants are some tropical grey woodlice and springtails, but I would love a group of dart frogs in there at some point. I'm curious, what species do you recommend?" So I'm a bit sorry about answering this a year and a half later. I think you most likely already have frogs. "I'm thinking Phyllobates vitatus after I saw your video about them, but I'm open to any other suggestions." I think Phyllobates vitatus are great beginner frogs. I think the only like catch to them is that they can be a bit shy at times, and I mean, I still love my Vitatus, they are really amazing frogs, but if it's your only frog species, then maybe I would consider getting a slightly bolder one, because it's very anxiety inducing when you're a beginner to have a frog that's really shy and you don't see them eat and stuff like that. So if you go for like a Tinctorius or a Terribilis or something, then you will have a guaranteed bold frog. So that can be a bit convenient, but Vitatus are great as well if you have the patience. Anyway, so the Vivarium does look a bit on the dry side, but I definitely have a feeling that the humidity increased over time. Oh, right! You can't see the Vivarium, I'm so sorry. Here it is. Yeah, so the Vivarium looks a bit on the dry side, but I think that's probably something that was increased over time. Something that I would be a bit... that I would be a bit more worried about is the wood here. I mean, I'm guessing it's waterproof, because otherwise this won't really last very long. I'm not quite sure what's going on here. But I mean, if we put that aside, because I really don't know what's the situation. I think the tank looks really good. One thing that I really like about it is the fact that there's a lot of usage of different levels. So, I mean, okay, there is a background, and it's fairly flat, but you still get a lot of the 3D aspect with all of these height differences with hardscape and substrate behind them and stuff like that. So I definitely appreciate that, and I think that's something that a lot of us can take some inspiration from. It's a really nice way of planting your vivariums, in my opinion. So I really like it. Obviously, I think they probably sprayed it down to make it a bit more humid since this picture was taken, because it's very common for vivariums to look a bit dry when they are freshly planted. There were actually multiple pictures of this one, I think. But yeah, I think it's same deal. Really nice looking tank. One thing that I do notice is all the scratches in the glass doors. I'm assuming this is plexiglass because of all of these scratches. You won't regret getting some normal glass instead, because these scratches, at least to me, they're like a big deal if it was one of my vivariums. But aside from that, I think you did a really great job of creating a nice 3D aspect, and you're getting some appreciation for that in the chat. Unfortunately, I can't get the chat to be on the screen above my face cam, which I was intending to, and it worked a few days ago when I was trying this out, but it doesn't work now, so the chat messages won't be in the video. But yeah, really nice looking tank, good job. I think this is like an 8 out of 10. Probably it's a bit on the like freshly planted side, but it definitely has a lot of potential with all of these interesting hardscape elements and stuff like that. So, time for the next one, and this is the first new one. So, this next person definitely knows they are in the live stream, unlike possibly the 5 last people, in case they forgot about it and like stopped watching the channel or something. You never know. Okay, so Vivarium number 6. Which one is that? Here it is. Okay, so this guy sent 2 of their vivariums. Let's see if I can find it. Where the heck is it? Okay. Okay. Maybe like that. No. So here we have another paludarium. So this one houses 5 Dendrobatus leucomelas, which are somewhere around here. You can't see the vivarium, right. Let's see. Here it is. You are curious to hear what I have to say about your tank. You will definitely get to hear that at some point. I'm not sure where you are in the line, but yes, now it should be showing at least. So this is the first vivarium they sent. I will be looking at them one by one because they sent a lot of pictures. So this one houses a few Dendrobates leucomelas, and it's a Yule aquarium. Once again, I personally hate using aquariums, but I mean, if you feel like you appreciate having a very inconvenient lid, I mean, go ahead. There is the advantage that you have like a solid glass pane at the front, which is great at least. So there are a few more pictures here. I have some beautiful moss growth here on the cork bark and stuff like that. And here is also one of the frogs that you can see, which is great. Here's another one. And we also have some pictures from the construction process. And here we have the substrate and the frog itself. So I think the main thing that I'm reacting to is the fact that this cork bark panel is just like submerged underwater, and I have a feeling that it will actually be that this will be kind of soaked and most likely like break down and fall apart after some time. That's one of like the disadvantages of having a paludarium, is that there are those risks. But aside from that, I don't think like the size of the water feature is a problem in this one, unlike some other paludariums, because it definitely doesn't take up all the usable space. If it was my vivariums, I would just like fill it with substrate, because I think a water feature doesn't really add much, but that's a very subjective opinion. I think this is a really beautiful tank. I'm not sure about the sustainability of this whole construction here, but I suppose you will figure that out in time. And yeah, I think it looks pretty good. I'm not sure about... Yeah, I suppose this is just an aquarium lid here, and I guess the frogs could jump up there, I don't know. I really don't know what I'm talking about in that sense. Is it not showing? You should be able to see the vivarium right now, I think. Yeah, I'm pretty sure you can. So I think it looks pretty good. Is it your vivarium loft here? Yeah, maybe. If it's your vivarium and if these ones, feel free to let me know, because I might not... You can hear the misting system going off in the background. If any of these are your vivariums, please let me know in the chat so I know that you're here, if you feel like that. Because I won't recognize... Yes, it's yours. Okay. Yeah, amazing tank. I'm definitely confident that you will figure it out over time. Great looking tank. I think it's also like... 7-8 probably, because it's a really nice one, and it seems like it's kind of a, you know, a sustainable plant selection and stuff. Nothing really to comment on there. So 8 out of 10, I think. Yeah, really nice one. Let's see if we can find the next one. Actually, you sent in two. Yes, Abel, I think I got your email. I'm pretty sure I know which one you are referring to. It should appear in the stream. Okay, so here we have the next vivarium from the same guy. And this one, I am... Yeah, moss is definitely going to look really great in that one over time, I think. I definitely agree. So this is another different vivarium from the same person, from Loftir. Yeah, I'm reading that correctly. So this one houses fire-bellied toads instead, the Bombina orientalis. And I have to say, I mean, nothing against the previous tank, but I'm a huge fan of this one, definitely. And I think this is... probably going to be the first 9 out of 10 today. These are more aquatic frogs. These are obviously not dart frogs, so they definitely appreciate the huge water feature, I think. And you have some nice moss growth here in the waterfall and everything like that. Yeah, I think this is a very nice looking setup. Let's see. Yeah, we have a good overview here. It might get a bit overgrown with time, I don't know. I think this fern is like a Neprolephis cordifolia kind of species, some very close relative to that one. And I can say they get really huge, and it's difficult to remove them once they get big. I had one in my biggest vivarium, and I had to take the scissors to go like around the whole plant, just cutting in the soil to get rid of all the long roots and take it out, which was very annoying, but it is very beautiful. Yeah, I think I'm assuming there should be a pump somewhere because this is a very big one, but Loftir will be better at responding to that one. Yeah, you went from aquarium to terrarium. That definitely makes sense. Yeah, they will have to be trimmed, but I don't think that's a bad thing. And I mean, the frogs, they love an overgrown tank. So I think this is definitely a 9 out of 10, possibly even like a 9.5. Pumpahedron right side, pumping it out to waterfall in the middle. Has shrimp and snails to break down organic. Yeah, great looking one. 9.5 out of 10, I think. For a 10, we're saving it up for something really special if there is going to be one. Let's see, next one. We're currently on number 7 out of 18 so far, and I think I may have gotten some new ones. Yeah, at least one new one I have. That will be very fun. Okay. Was that? Yeah, that was number 6. Now we have number 7. So now we have the creeping fig is also a fast grower. I've had it grow out of mesh topped vivariums several times. Yeah, I do actually have on the vivarium over there. You can see it, and I'm not going to change my camera angle. But I do have a Markgravia that's climbing out of the ventilation right now, and it's like pretty long. I'm just saving it up for the fun of it because it's very interesting to see like a long plant just hanging out of the vivarium. Really interesting. Okay, let's see. Next vivarium. So these ones are a bit different, and I'm not really sure if we are going to rate it on the same scale. But this is a tarantula vivarium. So if you have serious arachnophobia, then you can like turn off the video and just listen to me for like 2 seconds, and I will let you know when they are gone. So this is a small enclosure that houses an Acanthus guria geniculata. Let me see if I can find the message. This is my Acanthus guria geniculata enclosure. She's a juvenile and her name is Silk. As you probably can see, I made the enclosure myself and I have used buttons as locks. I definitely think this is a really good looking enclosure to be a tarantula enclosure. For those of you who don't know, I used to be. Yeah, it's yours. Great. I think this is really well made, and it's a lot more effort than I would put into my tarantula enclosures for my spiderlings and stuff. I have my tarantula shelf behind me, and that spider is actually the same species. I've had her since she was this big, and now she is massive. You can't really see her that well, but you can see it in my collection tour. Really amazing tarantula species, I have to say. And so, for those of you who don't know, tarantulas, they really don't need that much room. They basically just dig a burrow and stay there. And if they get like a huge If they have a huge tank in and they constantly move around in it, then that's almost a red flag that they haven't like settled in and stuff. So yeah, I think this is a perfect enclosure for a baby tarantula, obviously. And here you can also see the very nice locking mechanism here, the lock mechanism. Yeah, I think this is really good. I'm probably not gonna rate it because, I mean, it's a very different kind of setup, but it's definitely really good, and it's a lot more effort than I would put into my tarantula vivariums, at least for the baby tarantulas. I think those were all the pictures of that one. So, next one. How long has it been? It's been 44 minutes and we are almost halfway through. This is going to take a while, but it's great. It's amazing content. And I get a lot of watch time for this, so that's perfect. Let's see who's the next one. Here it is. Let's see here, 2 seconds. Yeah, this is a very interesting one, actually. So, this vivarium is, let me read the text. It's 60 centimeters wide and 90 centimeters tall exoterra. It's my first terrarium and it's now 9 months old. I got all my plants from some local garden center. Thus, I only have a small collection of suitable plants to choose from. The terrarium houses 2 male leucomeles, which are now 1.5 years old. The frogs are not bold at all. Every time I open the terrarium doors, they bail. They should have enough hiding places to feel comfortable, I guess. Maybe the group is too small. I wanted to buy a few more bromeliads, but all of them had spikes on their leaves, which I fear may injure the frog skin. Also, some leaf litter will be added soon, as the old one decomposed already. If I were to set it up again, I would definitely drill the bottom of the terrarium. Also, I would not include small pine bark into my substrate, but rather use large pieces of pine bark. The small pine bark easily sticks to my frog skin and they end up on my plant's leaves. It does not look too fancy. Happy to hear some feedback. So I think this is a very interesting setup. And I really like this cork bark panel route they went for the background. It's obviously not the fanciest choice out there, but it's the option that I tend to do nowadays. These are definitely some nice bromeliads. I have seen them once in a garden center. It's not very common to see them there. But yeah, I think these are probably the nicest looking bromeliads you can find. I don't really like most of the red Neurogelias and stuff like that. I think these are just the Vricia Splendens or Vricia Era or something like that. I think they are among the best ones you can find. He said he will add more leaf litter, and I think that would be great because it doesn't really look like there is a lot there. I can see why the pine bark is sticking to the frog skin. But I mean, aside from that, I think it's a really nice setup. I could not tell that you had got these plants from a garden center if I would have guessed. Aside from the Fittonia here, because that's kind of a giveaway. But aside from that, this looks like plant that you could. They look like plants that you could get from some vivarium store. Yeah, these are really amazing bromeliads. I have a lot of them. So one thing that I personally do in my newer vivariums is that I take the cork bark panels and I kind of scratch the surface of it, because here it's very clear, this is where you broke it off, and this is, how it looked when you got it, just, the flat surface. Hello, Christopher Bludau. You can send the pictures to the email address in the description if you... you can send it to the email address in the description, and they will be towards the end of the stream if you want to be featured. Yeah, so I would definitely try to scratch the surface if I did a different one. And also something, I did the same thing where I had the background only go not to the top, but to stop a bit before the top of the vivarium. I did that for some of my older vivariums and I really regret it. I wish I would have just taken it to the full height, because I think that looks much better, and it's also kind of difficult to get away to get rid of calcium stains and stuff on the glass above it, but that's definitely fine. I mean, I have the same thing in at least one of my vivariums nowadays, but it's something that I would like to change personally. So, but that's a matter of taste, though. Regarding the boldness thing of the frogs, that's That's a difficult question. I did make a video about how to get shy frogs to be more bold, and I'm assuming you have watched that one, because that seemed like what you were referring to. Yeah, it's a tough question and it's a bit individual, but in my experience, if you stay around the enclosure for a while around feeding time, then they typically just learn that there's food, they can come out to eat, and you're not going to hurt them while they do. So, yeah, that usually works in my experience. And giving them time is also a great option, but you may have already done that if I am interpreting the message correctly. I'm not quite sure. But yeah, pretty great looking tank in my opinion. I couldn't tell that these were garden center plants aside from the phytonias. And I think, let's see. I saw a guy that got like 10-15 centimeter thick corkwork plates and carved big burrows and details, etc. in them. Looked very good and yet natural. Yeah, if you want to get like really thick panels, then that's definitely like the best option because then you have a lot of depth to work with. I have the same ones as you most likely. Or the same ones as this guy. So there's not really that much to work with. You can kind of just like scratch the surface a bit and then you're kind of done because there's not much to do with 2 centimeters. But yeah, it's a very interesting background option. I am a bit curious about how long the corkwork panels will hold, or how long it will be until they start breaking down and falling apart. It should be quite a while, but I'm not sure because I have only recently tried it. Yeah, I think this is definitely a 7 out of 10. I'm considering if it's an 8. But I think like the simplistic background probably keep, but you have really great depth as well with all of these branches and the plants, so I'm going to give it a 7.5, I think. Actually, did we look at the other pictures they sent? We didn't actually do that. Here you can see it from a slightly different angle. And here are the frogs, obviously. Yeah, I think it's 7.5. Great job. Let's see here if we can bring up the next ones. Number 9. We are officially halfway through. All right, this is so this guy actually sent a whole Google Drive file. May I ask what you study? Biology, maybe. So I actually do, in Sweden we call it gymnasium. I think it's like upper secondary school or something, and I take nature science classes. Not sure what it will become of me afterwards. I'm thinking of becoming a teacher because that would be really fun. But yeah, the science related subjects are definitely what I prefer. We will see what happens. Okay, so this guy just shared a Google Drive file, and it was so good that I'm just going to share that. Let me see if I can also find the email. Hi, Emmanuel. I'm a herper from Sweden, and I've been enjoying your dart frog videos for a while now. You are so very close to getting me to jump on the dart frog bandwagon. Keep up the good work. Here's a quick selection from my setup. A crested gecko. We will see all the animals eventually. And he also has some very interesting technical solutions. So here are some of the animals that we are going to see their tanks eventually. So there were a few leopard geckos and a crested gecko. You can tell that this one is a male for obvious reasons. We also have I've not maybe that's a different crested gecko. This is yours. Great. You had some very interesting pictures here. I saw them briefly this morning when I was downloading them, so will be very interesting. This was Felsuma klemmeri, definitely like if I were to get another gecko species, which I most likely won't because dart frogs are so fun, but if I was to get another, I think this would be the ones because they are so beautiful. Here's another leopard gecko and another leopard gecko. Let's see. We also have an overview of the whole reptile room, especially the empty shelves. They are really great. No, I'm just kidding. So here we can see the setups. It's a bit, you know, pick and mix, like different sizes and stuff, but I think that's a nice aesthetic still. So we have the two leopard geckos, crested geckos, and Phocima clemerae, I think. And I think they might have had some different vivarium as well for another Phelsuma, I think. And there is also some kind of sunset kind of technical solution here, or a nightlight or something. Let's see. And also some homemade signs. You can see that this guy is Swedish and seemed to like Shakespeare. With some very nice homemade signs here on the vivariums. Yeah, I think that was the overview. And then we also have the tanks, which is of course the most interesting part. Yeah, you had to separate the Phelsumas due to fighting. Yeah, you mentioned something like that. I thought I wouldn't continue reading the email because that kind of spoils all the technical solutions. So I think this was the crested gecko vivarium. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure. And I guess this is the same one. This is a really beautiful background, actually. I have never done a background this good in my life, because I just don't put any effort into backgrounds. It's, and I, even if I did, I couldn't beat this, probably. And here's it at night, I suppose. And I guess this is the Phelsumas due to the bamboo, but I'm not sure. And here we have a different angle. And here are the leopard gecko tanks as well. I'm assuming this is like excavator clay or something like that. And some nice plastic plants and really nice looking substrate. I kind of, you know, think it's very interesting to see like different substrates from arid places and areas. I have my Monstrotropus balfouri vivarium here, which I wanted to make something like kind of similar, and I went out and dug up substrate from nature. I'm not sure if you have used some kind of product here or something instead. You can correct me in chat if I'm wrong. And here is a Phelsuma vivarium again. This one is really nice looking, very like overgrown kind of aesthetic, which I definitely like. And the gecko has like a lot of space to get back and stuff like that. Let's see, here's another leopard gecko vivarium. I have to say, I do prefer this one with less plastic plants, but maybe that's just me because I have seen those plastic plants everywhere by now. And here's a plant holding tank. So I'm not sure if we are going to rate all of these ones, but I think the crested gecko tank is a really great one. It does look a bit strange from this angle and stuff, but the background is like really amazing. So it's like at least a 9 out of 10, I think. I'm not sure, maybe the planting is holding it back a bit because it seems to be just golden pothos, but and I guess this is a philodendron melanochrysum, or a very big philodendron micans, I'm not sure. The leopard gecko substrate is unwetted excavator clay. Yeah, that's interesting. Does it really look like that? I haven't really seen that very much. But yeah, I think this is a great setup, and especially the background is really nice looking. So I think the crested gecko tank gets like a 9 out of 10, and I'm not going to like mention every single one because that would take a while. We also have some technical solutions here. So there is like a surveillance camera for them, so you can check on your animals when you're not at home, which is very interesting. I haven't really considered that. Let's see. And it says recording unit and cables, so I guess this is connected to the camera in some way. Very interesting solution. And here you can see the different cameras, so you can keep track of them when you're not at home, which is very interesting, definitely. And there were some videos as well from the surveillance from the cameras, but I think we have to keep going. So yeah, great looking tanks, definitely 9 out of 10 for the Crested Gecko Vivarium, and great job. Let's see if we can find the next one. Let's open up these ones. Oh yeah, this is an interesting one. Let's see if I can find the message as well, and of course I'm going to show it so you can see it as well. This is... So this message says, "Hi, big fan of your videos and helpful advice on Facebook. If you are in any of the American or the Swedish Dartfrog Facebook group, you will most likely find me there at some point, maybe in the comment sections. Your videos have given me a lot of inspiration as I grow out my first enclosure and frogs. Thank you. Here's the story of the enclosure in my pictures. It's an Exoterra with two roughly 4 months old leucomelas that I planted towards the beginning of December. I was hand misting up until about a week ago when I installed the mist king I got for Christmas. Great idea, really amazing plan to wish that you get a mist king for Christmas, because I mean it's the best Christmas gift you can get and it's also really expensive, so definitely appreciate that." Someone said, "Dingosaurus 12 says, I gotta go to work now. I'm going to miss my submission, but the background is really awesome. You will definitely get the submission featured in the video because I will edit all of this if I get around to doing that. I should definitely do that. So this should be in a video at some point where you will most likely be featured." Okay, so overall I could probably use some advice. This is the message again. "Overall I could probably use some advice on filling in some gaps in the enclosure and just general plant care." So it's very interesting that the Mist King has made plants deteriorate that were previously thriving. I haven't really had exactly the same situation aside from like planting a few orchids or bromeliads in like slightly too wet spots. It's definitely something that can occur, but I think just moving around plants and learning how they all work is definitely a good start. There were actually multiple pictures here, let me see. This plant I'm a very big fan of. It's a Begonia vancouverii, however that's pronounced, I'm pretty sure at least. I kind of like this, you know, green, very discreet plants that don't really stand out too much. They just contribute to like a natural environment without being like variegated or super super colorful or something like that. But a really nice plant actually. Very small detail, but still. I have to say, to be honest, this plant I'm slightly less of a fan of because they look really boring when they when the flower dies. I prefer the Vericias that we have. I think we were not referring to the same plant. This one is definitely a Calathea, or now it's Guapetia. I can't remember the species name. I was referring to this one to the side, which I'm pretty sure is a Begonia. I'm not entirely sure on the species, but it should be vancouverii. But yeah, this is a Calathea and this is Scindapsus something. But yeah, I think this is a Guzmania bromeliad, which tend to look a bit boring after they have stopped flowering, but you will see how that turns out. This is also a great choice of background plant. This is a Ficus punctata, I think. And the reason I say that is because they grow very slowly. If you get the normal Ficus pumila, they will invade the whole vivarium extremely quickly, and then you will have to trim it very frequently. So yeah, those are a bit slower growing, which is definitely great in many circumstances. Sometimes it can also be a bit boring because you're very impatient, but that really depends. Looks like some nice jewel orchid here. Lodicea Discolor maybe. But yeah, so here was the tank. You were looking for some advice on how to fill in some spots. I would personally try to find some nice big leaved plants that will plants with large leaves that will kind of climb on the background, because I personally, I mean, I'm a big philodendron and monstera fan, but I think in general that's most likely what the vivarium needs right now. Because it would be great to have some kind of 3D element that goes a bit above the stuff you have on the ground and stuff. Aside from that, I mean, I think there's a lot of leaf litter in here. You love to see it, and it's also a nice looking background with this nice ledge and stuff like that. Yeah, I think adding some like bigger philodendrons, maybe philodendron mandayanum or some monstera adansoniae or something like that, could probably elevate the setup a bit if you're looking for plant advice. But I think this is a really amazing start. It's like, it's not very grown in yet, so I can't really give it that high of a score, but it could definitely become like an 8 or 9 over time, but for now I think I'm going to give it like a 6.5 maybe. I think that's suitable, but it has a lot of potential, and some bigger plants could definitely do a great job at helping. So I think that's it for that one. Let's see what we have next. Here we have number 11 by now. Oh, this is a really great one, actually. Let me see if I can get this to work. Great. So, I also have to find the message. You can tell that I have three different screens that I'm looking at. It's quite an interesting setup. Let's see. I think it's this one. Yeah, it should be. Okay. Yo, here are some of my vivaria. The first big one houses 3 Dendrobates auradus CRBL. I guess the CR is Costa Rica. I'm not sure about what BL is. I mean, you usually hear green and black, so I guess that would be GB, but I'm not sure about BL. Oh, it's yours. Yeah, this is Abel's vivarium, and you also mentioned your Instagram at Rare Fruit Collector. So feel free to follow at Rare Fruit Collector if you want to. I will probably include that in the video or something. So I think I'm very jealous of the beautiful Monstera obliqua Peru here. I have a very tiny one, and it got 4 leaves in 2 years by now. I've had it for 2 years, bought it for like, when it was a bit more expensive than what it is now, it was still not very expensive. But I have 4 leaves from it, and the biggest one is this big and doesn't have any fenestrations. So yeah, amazing plant you have here. And yeah, definitely like the branches with moss and stuff. I would definitely add a lot more leaf litter here, because you have a lot of substrate that can kind of get stuck on a frog skin, which can be very annoying. And you know, there is obviously a lot of leaf litter where they live in nature, but that could also be like you haven't added more. There's a better looking one in the back. Yeah, there definitely is one here. Really nice one. Same thing for the anthurium here. I think this is crystallinum, correct me if I'm wrong. I have one of them as well in one of my grow out tanks, and it's just growing completely out of control. Yeah, I would take it out before it's too depressing, because when they get like so massive roots and stuff like that, then it's a bit annoying. But they are great plants, and I mean, there's nothing wrong with keeping it there, of course. So yeah, great obliqueas. I'm very interested in what this plant is. I haven't really seen. It looks kind of like something you would. It's not the frog tank, but I can't. I'll say when it's up. Yeah, amazing. Yeah, if this was frogs, it would probably be more leaf litter. I mean, that's not really a big issue, obviously, in this case. Apologies for that. So, is this the frog tank, though? I have to read the message again. The other ones aren't inhabited by anything yet, but I'm sure they will have some Ranitmea or Ophaga sooner or later. Okay, so only one of them has frogs, which I think we will see which one that is. I definitely prefer the last one because of the kind of all the, I guess this is super glue or something that shines through on the Hygrelon and stuff. But when it is a bit more grown in, I think Hygrelon tanks have a lot of potential even with a simple background. And I mean, I do the same thing, so I shouldn't really say much. And I think this is the same as the last one. This one is 2 weeks old, the tall one. Yeah, that's I think this one has a lot of potential once it's a lot more grown in and once the Hygrelon is covered and all of that. Wait, I'm back on this one. Is this the same one? Yeah, it's the same one. Okay. And I guess this is a different one. I mean, my eyes are drawn towards like the water feature here. It definitely looks like the substrate is saturated, but I'm not really sure about that. Maybe this is some like weird lava rocks or something that won't absorb the water. As I said before, I'm pretty sure you will figure it out. Even though it wouldn't be something, I wouldn't recommend like a beginner to set up a water feature like this where the water is like in contact with the substrate, but it should definitely be fine if you figure it out over time, I think. Yeah, I think those were all the pictures. Not sure which one housed the frogs. I thought I had seen one of the frogs but when I looked at them this morning. But I think this one looks the best, in my honest opinion. But the other ones definitely. Yeah, that's lava. Okay, yeah, great. Then it shouldn't be a problem or anything like that. Yeah, I think these tanks look really great, and I think I will just rate one of them. This one definitely has potential, but I think I will rate this one like an 8 out of 10 because it's has a really nice plant selection and some nice depth and stuff like that. So yeah, maybe actually this is a 9. This is a 9 out of 10, I think. I'm curious, are we going to see a 10 out of 10 here today? That's the question. Great job at this one. Let's see, number 12. Yeah, right, this is I mentioned this one earlier actually. So this is, wait, what's going on? Okay, great. No, that's not what I meant to do. Okay, here it's back. So this is the aquarium that someone sent in. I will try to find the message as well. Hey Gecko Geek, this is a picture and a video of my aquarium. I only included a picture, but yeah. Hope you include it in your live stream slash video. It's a Denerle Scaper's tank, 55 liters with a Twin Star 45 ELLL light. I do use carbon dioxide in my vivarium for better plant growth. For plants, I use different types of mosses, stem plants, and epiphytes. The tank is well over 4 months old now. Good luck with your first live stream. Greetings from Belgium. So thank you for the submission. I'm probably not going to rate this one because I have never kept like a good. I've never kept an aquarium in my life aside from like a really shitty blackwater tadpole tank, which you might have seen in my last video. But I think it's a really great looking one with like a lot of the lushness factor. If I wanted to set up an aquarium, I wouldn't be able to do it this well, but I would try to go for the same kind of aesthetic, which is with just a bunch of overgrown plants and stuff like that, I think. So yeah, great job. I'm not gonna rate it because I think that would be a bit weird. But yeah, good looking aquarium, definitely. It's definitely the best looking aquarium in the stream. Okay, let's find the next one. So here we have a new species actually, which is a bit exciting. So here we have a gargoyle gecko vivarium. Let me see if I can find it. Hello, this is my viv for my one-year-old gargoyle gecko Django. And he's sitting up here, and I also got some pictures of... That's not how to change a picture once again. You have new mail. Yeah, I will check that towards the end of the stream, in probably like 40 minutes or something. Great to have some more submissions, so the video can be longer. Here we also have some close-ups of the gargoyle gecko, really nice looking species. I've only kept crested geckos myself, but they should be very similar in character to the gargoyle geckos. It's your tank. Great. So I think my tank looks pretty good, with a nice background and stuff like that. I think you could definitely use the volume of the tank a lot more with like adding more branches and perhaps a few like really huge plants or something. I usually like to say with like crested geckos and stuff like that, that if you look at the tank from the side, you shouldn't like be able to see from side to side. And I think that's like a pretty good measurement to like see how well the space is utilized. So I would most likely try to get like some big philodendrons or pothos or something like that and kind of squeeze them in, or perhaps a few more branches. But aside from that, I think you have a pretty good aesthetic going on. I think this definitely has a lot of potential. For now, I'm going to give it a 6, but if you add like more branches and stuff like that, I think it could definitely be really great. So yeah, nice looking tank. Let's see if we can find the next one. Let's see here. Back to this one. Is the camera out of focus? Or maybe it's just bad stream quality. I have no clue. It should be fine, I think. Okay, number 14. We are getting closer and closer to the end. But then there are plenty of new ones as well. Let's see here, let's take it here. Okay, great. So this is, let me see. So the last person who had the gargoyle gecko said, I'm upgrading him to a 60 by 60 by 60 in 3 months and I'm doing a whole new tank. Yeah, I mean, sounds good. It should definitely be great. The geckos are like, they like to utilize a lot of space, so the gecko will definitely be happy. Like the current tank is definitely fine, but I think trying to like squeeze in a lot of branches so you can't like see all the way towards the back is really fun. Hello, Johan Löfman. Nice to hear that you are having a fun time watching this. Let's see, this is... actually the first vivarium here that comes from someone who at least I'm sure that I have met. Maybe one of the previous ones did as well, I'm not entirely sure. Let me see if I can show it to you as well. So I also have to find the message. It's taking a while, but that's fine. Hi, this is the homemade vivarium that houses the 5 Dendrobates leucomelas Guiana banded I bought from you. So yeah, this guy actually bought his frogs from me, and I think he was in the chat earlier, I'm not sure, maybe he will come back, or maybe he isn't. I think I'm mixing them up, but yeah. So this guy actually bought his frogs from me a while back, and visited the frog room and everything. This is my first, and reading the message again. This is my first and only vivarium. There's a lot of things I definitely would have done differently. Since I didn't and still don't know anything about plants, a lot of the plants have either died or are currently dying because they aren't suitable for the environment. I think the biggest problem with it is the lack of plant coverage, but I would love to hear what you have to say. So I'm not entirely sure, but it looks like the vivarium could potentially be a bit too wet. Maybe from like too little ventilation, and I think maybe some of the plants would be a bit happier if you would increase the humidity a bit. So yeah, I would assume that's the reason the plants are dying at the moment, The leaf litter also looks really wet, so I guess that's like the indicator that tells me this is probably a bit on the wet side. So I think if you were to slightly increase the amount of ventilation, then you could probably have some improvement in that regard. We also have some more pictures here. So we have some close-ups. I also have to say though, if you're killing plants, but this one, this is a Begonia prismaticarpa, the cutting is probably from me, I think. If this one is surviving and doing well, then your setup is like great. These are really easy to kill if you aren't careful, if it gets too wet or too dry or anything like that. But yeah, maybe some of the other plants in here think it's a bit too wet, most likely. That's my best guess, at least. It's also really nice, this big frog with all of this algae and stuff. I would probably take it out and clean it, because I wouldn't want all the algae to spread to all of the scape and stuff, because that's very annoying. But it looks really good on the frog here. Let's see, and here's a different close-up. Yeah, I think it's a mix of the issue you mentioned with the plants dying. I think it's a mix of the wrong plant species and possibly it being a bit too wet, with it not like drying out that much. So I think that's probably the main advice that you're looking for. This is a really big vivarium, and it's not actually an aquarium like you might think at first. I'm pretty sure this is one giant sliding glass door that will just slide up to the side, kind of like my tarantula tanks up here, which is an aesthetic I liked going for, because then you won't have the ugly glass overlapping in the middle like I have down here, which you can't really see, but I have it. So I'm pretty sure this is just one gigantic door, which is really nice. I personally hate using aquariums. If you like it, go ahead, but I think it's really annoying. But yeah, you could probably improve the plant life a bit with a bit less moisture and a bit more ventilation, and possibly just switching out a few species that aren't optimal for the environment, but I think it's a great job, and I think the enclosure is like basically homemade, so that's definitely a plus. So I think at the moment it's like a 6, but if you get the plants to start going, then it definitely has a lot of potential to climb a lot higher. So let's see if we can find the next one. Where do you sell your frogs? I usually advertise them on the Swedish forums. I will put some links in the chat. If you are a Swedish dart frog keeper, you should definitely check out plift.se, which is a big site from the Swedish Dendrobatid Society, which is basically a massive association of dart frog keepers. That's also the main source of information on the Swedish, in Swedish at least. You will find my ads popping up there, and there is also a frog day, both in the spring and in the fall, and I usually sell some frogs at the one that's in the fall. So you might see me there if you are Swedish, and if you're not Swedish, I have gotten requests in like my YouTube comments, like, do you ship to China and do you ship to Texas? I unfortunately don't do that, I'm sorry. You have to be Swedish and be willing to drive either to me near Gothenburg or to the next frog day to buy frogs from me, or arrange some kind of transport by yourself. But yeah, I do sell some small frogs occasionally. I think it's time for the next vivarium. Which one is that? We are at number 15, so it's almost time for the new submissions. I have 18 old ones. Okay, this is a lot of images first, actually. This is going to take a while, this one. Yeah, we have a lot of different animals here. That's interesting. Okay, so here we have a big mix of... unfortunately, I can't really sell to anyone outside of Sweden. And I also sell like very common and basic frog species, so it would be really expensive if you try to like get in contact with someone who can transport the frogs for you. That would just be so expensive. So you can just buy frogs from someone in the Netherlands instead. I think you have some nice sellers there. Here we have a variety of animals, and I also have to find the message first. Hello, my name is Alan, and I just wanted to say your vivariums are beautiful and your content has helped me gain the courage to get dart frogs myself. Great to hear. Dart frogs are really amazing pets. I hope you enjoy them. Anyway, the first images are of my 18x18x24-inch vivarium housing a trio of Ranitmea amazonica equidos. This is not a vivarium housing Ranitmea amazonica equidos because I downloaded all the pictures in the wrong order, I think. They are probably my favorite animals that I own. Fantastic, they are objectively better pets than snakes. I mean, who are we kidding here? Dart frogs all the way. That's a joke. I'm hoping for some eggs soon, but I don't know if there's a female in the trio as I bought them before they were sexed. They've got me hooked on dart frogs and I can't wait to get more. Below that is my pet. I think I will just show the videos one by one and we will see what happens. Okay. So this is a garter snake, I'm pretty sure they are called in English. Here we have a massive paludarium, which fortunately doesn't house any dart frogs. If this one housed any dart frogs, I would unironically give it like a 2, because dart frogs don't utilize the whole water feature. But this one doesn't house any dart frogs. This one houses predator. Yeah, I think it houses. Wait. I think they house some various fish. Yeah, it just has a bunch of fish. I thought I read like predator fish, but yeah, I'm not sure. This one houses a bunch of fish in the water feature and nothing on land, as far as I'm aware. You can see a little fish here as well. I think it's a really amazing looking paludarium. As I said, just as an like a pedagogic, what is it called? As an educational example, this wouldn't be optimal for poison dart frogs, but for fish, it's definitely great, of course. Yeah, I think it's really great to have this kind of riparian style with like the plant. Not really riparian style, actually. I don't know what I'm talking about, but yeah, I think it's really beautiful. Here we also have, I think this was the dart frog tank, if I'm correct. There is also a yellow-headed gecko, which is a, I think it's a Gonatodes albugularis that's living together with the dart frogs, which is a fairly tried and tested combination, and it's a very small gecko, so it shouldn't really hurt the thumbnails, even though I wouldn't really risk it myself in this case. I would probably keep it together with like a bigger gecko, but not a very big deal. Yeah, there's also some mourning geckos, not in the same... Fuscus, right. Wait, which ones? Okay, I think they just look similar, I suppose. Yeah, Gonatodes albugularis or Fuscus, I don't remember the names. Here's a mourning gecko which lives in a different tank, and here's a Colombian rainbow boa. And here are the very beautiful Ranitmea amazonica equidos, really nice looking frog actually, and here's one of them in the vivarium. If this doesn't dry out occasionally, I have a feeling that the bromeliad is going to die. I might be wrong, but they usually do if like the stump is constantly wet like this, but maybe it isn't constantly wet like this, I don't know. And here is, which one was this? Let me see. Yeah, I think this was the Colombian rainbow boa, I think, yeah. Why can I not speak properly? Oh, there were more? Okay. I'm kind of losing track of which tanks are which. I think this was the Darkfog tank again. Yeah, they are probably very close to the ones that the imitators are imitating, at least. So basically, Renitmea imitators have something called Mullerian mimicry. So they basically try to imitate a different species. This is not because the imitators aren't poisonous and the other species is poisonous, but rather because if they are both poisonous, then they both gain an advantage from predators learning that they are poisonous. So if they look the same, you can look up Mullerian. I think it's Mullerian mimicry on Wikipedia if you feel like it. But it's kind of like both species benefit from looking the same way, which is very interesting. Ikiros and Varadero are very close to one another, so they are very near to each other. Does that make sense? Yeah, I think it does. Yeah. Do people sleep in the same room as Darkfogs? If so, do they ever keep you guys up? So this varies a lot depending on the species. So a few Darkfogs will be almost completely quiet. This includes Dendrobates tinctorius mostly. They are almost completely quiet unless you try to actively listen for them, which I don't really do that frequently. There are also some ones that are extremely loud, like the Epipedibatus anthonii. Those are definitely the loudest ones, at least of the common species. So I sleep right next to my Epipedibatus anthonii, and I can sleep through it in the night. But my dad has woken up through two closed doors at some point. But you kind of get used to it. It's kind of like if you live next to a train track, you will eventually just not hear the train or not notice it. It's kind of the same thing for the Darkfogs, I think. You eventually just get used to it, so I can sleep through it without an issue. So if you're a bit worried about the Darkfogs you're going to get, you can look up the species name and then call on YouTube, like Epiphytobates anthonii call, and then you will get to hear someone who has recorded it, so you know how loud each species is. Now we are on a big off track. Ikiros and Varadero are both locations in Peru, very close to each other. I think the Varadero imitator is imitating Fantastica Varadero, which is even more similar because these ones are like at least somewhat different, but yeah. That's a very massive sidetrack. We were supposed to review the Vivarium. This was the Colombian rainbow boa, right? So once again, I'm not... Oh, we have another one. I think this was the morning gecko tank. Most likely. Yeah, and maybe this is also a morning gecko tank. I really have no clue. I think I'm just going to review one of these vivariums. That's like the best looking one, probably. And I think it's probably, I mean, this is definitely the best looking one. I'm not a fish channel or an aquarium channel, but I think this is an amazing paludarium. So I would say this is like definitely a 9, and I can't say too much about paludariums to say anymore. And I think the Darkfog tank is also, here it is. I think the Darkfog tank is also really good looking. Definitely like at least a 7, and maybe more, I don't know. Let's see, that was a long review, but that's totally fine. That's interesting, of course. Let's see what number 16 holds for us. 16, we have that one here. Here we have 3 pictures of the same vivarium. I think this was the imitator Varadero tank, actually, that you were... Yeah, I think this is yours, Kalisha. Wait, is it? No, it's not. I'm just... Or? No, it's... I don't know. This is at least a tank that houses. I will just read the message. I don't know what. Hey Emmanuel, I'm hyped for your coming live stream today, and today morning I thought, why not send in my pictures as well? Please find the final photos of my very first terrarium/vivariums attached. This terrarium was finished in late August 2022, and I was very proud of me how it turned out. The photos were taken a few weeks after cycling at the date I got my first animals. It houses 4 Ranitmea imitator Varadero, which turned out to be 2 males and 2 females, which is great. Due to high numbers of tadpoles, I sold a pair of my adult frogs, but despite the current dry period in the terrarium, I still have tadpoles and a new froglet is always peeking out of the bromeliad. I think I'm doing this dry period wrong somehow. Can you maybe enlighten me? I'm currently keeping the humidity between 70 to 80% instead of 80 to 100. Despite asking in various groups, I've not received a clear answer, so I was afraid to go lower with the humidity. I could provide several photos showing the progress as well, however, this would go beyond the limits of an email, which is 145 megabytes. If I can somehow. So I think this is... this was yours, right? I was just confused by the different username. I think this is an extremely good looking tank especially for a first tank. I have some similar comments to one we had earlier, except I think this one looks even better, probably. I think it's great how you have like utilized the different heights with like kind of a, not a slope, but with like natural hardscape elements and stuff like that. I think that's really beautiful, and this is one of my favorites in this review video. Let's see, yeah, those were the pictures. Yeah, amazing looking tank. I think the imitators are very happy in there. What more? Regarding the dry period, that was something I mentioned in my last video about how to breed poison dart frogs, that sometimes it's nice to have like a dry period to kind of get them to stop laying eggs for a while, so they get to rest for a bit, so the parent animals won't get like burnt out or something. It's probably usually fine, because they will like eventually stop, in my experience. You could go a bit lower on the humidity, and I also don't know how long your dry period has been. But yeah, I think it's not something I would worry too much about. But yeah, really amazing looking tank. And I think it's like one of the cleanest layouts here, and it's still very interesting to look at. So I think this is definitely a 9. It might actually... I think this is the first 10 actually. Yeah, this one gets a 10 out of 10. I really like the clean layout and stuff. Really good looking tank. All the leaf litter and stuff like that. Maybe I would use like some different plants, but that's very like a personal subjective opinion. Like personally, I hate Nerugilia sows, which I think this one is, or at least these kinds of bromeliads. I think they aren't that pretty, but that's a very subjective opinion, so that shouldn't really be too big of a deal. And for the frog's sake and like the layout and stuff, I think it's really amazing. So great job. Let's see if we can find the next one. Is this the last one that I haven't... Yeah, I think this is the... No. No, we have 2 more. And then we have the new ones that were sent in. We have... Which one is this? Actually, this is... We have a good streak going right now, actually. These are some really, really amazing tanks. Wait, what's wrong here? Okay, so we don't have very high quality photos of this one. It's kind of like zoomed out, and if I zoom in, it's going to be very pixely. But this is probably my favorite vivarium out of all the ones I have seen. Let me find the message as well. Yeah, here is Here's the message. Okay. I think this is written in Danish or Norwegian, so it's going to be interesting to read. I'm not very... It's kind of similar to Swedish, but it's a bit difficult for me. Yeah, this is the biggest Exoterra that houses... this is also for Ranitomea Imitator Varadero. All the Imitator Varadero tanks today are on fire. Like, is this a coincidence, or is Ranitomea Imitator just, like, the best Dart Frog there is? It's also very interesting that this is... the background is Ben's Jungle's rainforest background, which I think is just, like, clay that you, like, stick on the wall, and then it, like, grows in. I think we had the guy who sent this one in chat earlier. I'm not sure if he's still here. But maybe... Oh, it is yours, Ola. I thought we had two different Olas in the chat, but I'm not sure. But yeah, I think it's very interesting that the Ben's Jungle background is is so successful. I have looked at it, but I haven't decided to use it or anything. But I suppose it's really good. I love the mangrove kind of look here, with the moss and all the plants. And I also like how there aren't any, like, plants that take too much attention. It's not like any... there are two red bromeliads, of course, but not like something, some massive plants that just takes over. And I think you should definitely keep it that way, just like no plants with large leaves on this one, because there's such a good background here that it would be kind of like an insult to the background to have a massive philodendron in here. So I think you did a great job with everything. I am curious about what this plant is. I saw a question in chat as well, but I have no clue what this is. So please enlighten me in the chat. This is a very interesting looking plant. I've never seen something similar to it. This is definitely a 10. We even had more pictures that I haven't even shown yet. Here we have a close-up as well of the left wall. And I guess this is like the middle of the mangrove and stuff. The longest one is Solanum oleanum, if it's got the spelling right. It's probably correct, I guess. It just looked like something... So this one, really? Okay, never actually heard of that species. I thought Solanums looked completely different, but apparently not. I will include the name in the YouTube video, probably, because people are most likely wondering. Yeah, amazing tank. We had other pictures here as well. A close-up of the flowering bromeliad as well. And I think this log here in the middle is, like, really great. And here we have, like, kind of from below. It's always really interesting to, like, look at your vivariums from above and from below, because you get so many, like, unique angles that you don't see straight from the front. It's very amazing to see sometimes. And here's one of the imitator Varaderos as well, with, like, 2 pixels wide. But yeah, despite the poor camera quality, this is the best one so far. But definitely, I love this one. A really great looking tank, so yeah, amazing job. It's too bright for it. It's supposed to be almost purple. Yeah, I think that's yeah, that's very interesting. I think I prefer it green, to be honest. Maybe I haven't seen it in person, but I don't know. So yeah, great job. Best vivarium so far. Yeah, too much light. Yeah, that makes sense. I don't know what I was going to say. I just said some weird stuff. I don't know. Yeah, best one so far. Congratulations. Amazing job. Let's see if the following ones can actually beat it. Another way to make the plant the way you want. Yeah, definitely. And now we have the final one that was sent in advance. Here we have it, and I have to find the message as well. Okay. Here are some pictures of my vivarium for your YouTube live that you can review. So there isn't actually, I have no clue what animals are inside of this one. I'm assuming it's dart frogs because otherwise there would most likely be a comment about it. I'm also pretty sure this is the background with the latex peat. I have only seen this on the Swedish forums, and we actually had Tobias Bokesten in chat earlier. He's at least one of the people who I've said seen use this technique. I think this should be latex peat at least, which is a it's like latex and peat, and just you just mix it up and make a background. Very interesting. I have been considering trying it myself. I have to comment on this water feature. I have no clue what's going on here. Maybe he just like recently added water, but this looks like death and disease. I don't think that's the case. It's probably just cloudy after like a water change or something. But yeah, I'm not quite sure what's going on here. Kind of like once again, I'm not going to like lower any of the ratings too much based on the water feature simply because I mean, I don't really know how they are set up. It's very difficult to tell from these pictures. You will probably figure it out, but maybe I would be a bit concerned about that. It's certainly easy for the frogs to get out of the water and stuff, and it doesn't take up too much of the space. Either new water or bacterial bloom in the water. Yeah, I'm hoping for the new water. I think that's most likely the case. But yeah, I would be a bit concerned about that, but you will most likely figure it out, so I won't like hold that against you or anything. I think the plant selection is pretty good. Once again, we had one of these palms earlier, or is that even the correct name? I'll put the Latin name here in the YouTube video, maybe. I don't know. I think this usually like either they die or they outgrow the vivarium at some point. And I mean, if you want to take out plants eventually, great. I don't want to take out plants eventually. That's a bit annoying for me, I think. But I think this one definitely has some potential. It has a nice orchid right here as well. Love to see it. Yeah, I think this is like a solid vivarium. Would be a bit concerned about the water feature. If it was my tank, I would just fill it with substrate and a drainage layer, of course, but I would just fill it up with substrate to give the dart frogs a bit more space. But yeah, great tank. I think it's like 6 probably, and yeah, 6.5, I think. It has potential. Once the plants are a bit more grown in, it's a bit difficult to rate it like something high when it seems freshly planted, which I'm pretty sure it is at least. So yeah, great tank, good job. So now we are at the very interesting point where we have new vivariums that I haven't seen yet, and I'm not sure if I should actually. Yeah, I think I have to like download them so I don't leak everybody's email address and stuff. Yeah, I will actually be right back in like 2 minutes and then we will continue the stream.
So
I can't seem to get my camera to come back, which is definitely an issue. You can see EOS webcam utility, you're not supposed to see that. It should be fixable. I hope, at least. We will see what happens now. So basically, I have my face cam back in like the extension I'm using for that. But it can't connect to OBS for some reason, which is like very strange. I don't know if I should like. Yeah, I'm trying to fix this. This is really annoying actually. Yeah, like I had to change the battery in the camera and now it's on again, and like the extension understands that the camera is on again, but I can't actually get OBS to understand that, which is like the software that I'm using. Actually, I could try to like. Can I like. Yeah, I will be back soon. Is it working? I think you can see me now. Amazing. That should be. Yeah, okay. Now everything is working again. I think you can see me now. Can you all see me again? I'm waiting for. Yeah, perfect. Amazing. So we have a few more vivariums to go. I have three, no? Yeah, three more submissions that I got. Wait, what? It's not three. Okay, 2 seconds. I think I forgot one of the like the folders. Be right back again. Okay, finally, everything is done. Now it should all be working, I think. I'm pretty sure. So we got a few more submissions that we are going to look at. We have four more, but one of them kind of doesn't count. You will see why. But let's start off with the first one, which is also from a person I have actually met, which is really fun. So this is from Tobias, who was actually in chat earlier. Here is the vivarium, and I will try to find the message as well. Here are two quick photos of mine. Quite a mess at the moment. One 20 centimeters tall, 50 deep, and 50 wide. It houses 10 plus Exhibitus mysteriosus in there, some UV light on top, fans on top, and at the bottom, protected by nets. Making like crazy. Lots of orchids, as you can see, mounted in pots at the sides. Just have to double check. Are we? Everything should be working right. We are back. Yeah, amazing. Just saw a chat message. So this is a very interesting setup. It's a very practical one if you want to culture a lot of orchids to like put on the walls and stuff. And this also utilizes the latex peat background method that I mentioned earlier. There is expanding foam in the back to like keep it intact, but then it's like a mixture of latex and peat that's just the background, which I have heard mixed opinions on, but it's definitely an interesting background option that can create like a lot of depth and stuff. I don't think there was a picture of. Or here it actually is. This is one of the Exhibitus mysteriosus. These ones don't actually exist in the US and in the UK, or well, in the animal trade in the US and the UK, due to some legal reasons, I think. So a lot of you probably don't have them, or maybe they are in the UK, but not in the US, I'm not sure. But they are here at least, which is very interesting. Extremely beautiful frogs, and I know a lot of like dart frog keepers who, I don't know, one specific dart frog keeper who has a massive collection, by far the biggest collection in Sweden, and he said that these ones were his favorite dart frogs out of all the ones he kept, which was like actually like 40 plus species at least. So yeah, very. You can. Are you in the US or in the UK? I'm just a bit curious. I think there is some issues in some countries at least. I'm not entirely sure. But yeah, it's a really amazing frog species. And also a really nice vivarium. It's very practical, as I mentioned, with like the I think the kind of nets you have on the sides here that makes it easy to hang up pots and stuff. I can't really like rate it a 10 or anything because I mean it's a practical setup, which I can't really say that this is very pretty the side thing, but it's definitely a nice setup, so I think it's like an 8 or something. And also really beautiful frogs you have there. So yeah, nice job. It's very weird to be rating a vivarium from someone who has definitely kept frogs way longer than me. But this is one of the vivariums that I've seen on different forums and stuff when I was researching getting into dart frogs, so very fun to see it submitted here to my own stream. So the next one, I can't really say that it's a submission, but I think you will love to see what it is still. So remember Ola, the guy who had the best vivarium so far. So he also sent his entire animal room now, which is very appreciated. Here you can see it. So this was the vivarium that we were looking at earlier, which was really pretty, I think. That's not how to change a picture. We have to zoom in a bit as well. Yeah, it's not very high resolution, but that's fine. Here you can see some of the other tanks. I suppose this houses some like day geckos or something, I think. Can zoom in even more actually. And here's also a very interesting tank, which most likely doesn't house starch frogs, I'm not sure. And here's a close-up of one of the tanks. I'm not going to grade this animal room because I already gave the enclosure a 10, and I think that's enough credit. The animal room itself looks really good and really clean, so it definitely holds a high standard, I think. So yeah, that's it for that one. Now we have two submissions left. One day I hope to have an animal room too. Yeah, that it's really... One day I wish to like be able to completely, not reset everything, but like have a room where you start with the plan of having it as an animal room, so you can like plan the space well and have a nicer layout kind of, because this is, my current animal room is like very improvised and stuff. So I'm looking forward to that day, whenever that day comes. Let's see if we can see the final two submissions here. Open these ones. So this guy didn't, I think he sent like screenshots from his Instagram or something, because he the vivarium lights were already closed, so he couldn't actually so he couldn't actually send the whole thing. But here are some of the screenshots from his Instagram. Let's see if I can find the message as well. Hello, I am from Germany, but I don't take pictures because the lights are off. And he also sent a list of his collection, which is Locomelas Guiana, Tinctorius Assyrius, Tinctorius Alanis, and Tinctorius Lafume, as well as Renitomea Benedicta and Renitomea Imitator Terrapodo. And his Instagram is Ronan's Jungle, which I will put here in the YouTube video, so you can check him out if you feel like it. Hello, Alfred Eriksson. Nice to see you here. So this was his setup. A few screenshots from his Instagram page, especially with a nice Freitag here. I think these are the... Are these even Alanis? No, these are the Lafumes, I think. And here are the Renitomea Benedictas. This is the Alanis. And here are some Dendrobates Assyrius. I'm pretty sure the substrate here is like some kind of, what's it called? What is it? Like filter foam, which I actually tried in my most recent setup, except I have like a ton of leaf litter on top of it, so you can't actually see it. But it's nice to see it used, because I think it's a very great option as substrate. Yeah, the first ones were Lafume and the second ones were different ones. I think it's a very interesting substrate option, because it won't like break down and it won't get saturated. It won't become like a bacteria herd or something like that, most likely. So far I'm very happy with the vivarium where I'm using it. And are the Benedictas red colored or more a dark orange? I think Christopher is going to respond to that himself, most likely, but I think they are pretty red. Alfred says, just got my first frogs, thank you for all your informational videos, really helped me out. Awesome to hear, great to hear that you appreciate it. Were there any more pictures here? No, those were... Oh, what? Yeah, those were all the pictures he sent. So I don't really have an exact vivarium to review. I guess I will have to like review this one. I mean, it's a very simple style with like the... I've been using the filter foam for the past 3 years. I like it a lot. Yeah, I definitely agree. Yeah, I think this is a very nice setup. Very simple kind of, but still definitely effective. It's not like... Maybe not the biggest like display vivarium that you would have, but it's very, very nice looking still. So I think I give these vivariums like 7 out of 10, maybe a 6.5 out of 10 or something. Yeah, I think a 7. And the animal room as a whole looks pretty good, even though I can't really see a whole overview, but I kind of like the layout with different exoterras of the same height. It's very interesting to see always. Hello, Green Machine Sweden. You have missed basically the whole live stream. We have one submission left, but great to see you here. Renitmia, Yuakaria, they are actually really great frogs. I haven't kept them myself, but they are really beautiful. Next stream, you will send better pictures. Sounds good. I feel like I will probably do this again if the video is going to do well. It's very fun actually to like get some inspiration from all of you and stuff. Let's see, and now we have the final submission here. Is it going to beat Ola's the best vivarium so far, or is it not going to? It's definitely a really good one. And we have some various other animals also, just some pictures and stuff. So, the final vivarium. This is a 90 by 45 by 90 centimeters, and it houses Dendrobates tincturius. I think these are powder blues, and some gold dust day geckos. Those are Felsuma. What is it? It's a Felsuma species. I will put the name here in the video. Let's see. So here we have one of the geckos. Here we have one of the frogs. Here we have one of the geckos again, and one of the frogs again. It's very interesting to see a frog swimming. If you are in any of the big international Facebook groups, you will notice that people are very opposed to dart frog water features because they can't swim, and it's very interesting to hear that every time because it's like basically bullshit. Wait, you can't see the pictures. I'm sorry. Okay, so here is the first picture of one of the geckos, Goldust Day geckos. Here's one of the frogs, a new gecko, and a new frog. And this was the swimming picture that I started ranting about. Yeah, it's very fun to hear always everybody scream that dart frogs can't swim. There is kind of a point to that dart frogs aren't great at swimming like long distances and stuff. But I think the main problem with water features isn't actually that, but rather the fact that it's kind of a waste of space since they don't like, it's not the environment that they live in. But you will see the whole vivarium, like this, or well soon. Another great picture. These were really high quality photos. The internet is opposed to anything related to animals. There's always something wrong. I kind of agree with you there. So this water feature, like, it is unnecessarily big. I'm like, definitely, and this is space that could be used by the frogs, but I definitely think there's still enough land area for me not to have a problem with it, at least. And aside from that, I think the vivarium looks really good. I see the hydrolon background here on top of some kind of expanding foam. So I think it's definitely going to become even prettier once the background is like completely covered in plants and stuff, so it's a bit more grown in. But I think this is a very solid vivarium to end on. Actually, I think there was... I have to reload the inbox. Yeah, I think this is... This should be the last one. You said you... JBean, you say you sent a picture. I haven't actually received it. So unless you can send it like right now, I'm probably not going to look at it because it takes very long to like download all the new images. But yeah, I think this is a very solid vivarium to end on. Really good looking one. And it looks like it's somewhat freshly planted, or you just have very slow growing plant species, which is also fine. But I think like in a few years, once the background is covered in creeping fig and stuff like that, it's going to be really great. Yeah. Frogs spend a lot of time in the upper part, so they use a lot of upper space. Yeah, I mean, it's great to hear. It's a really nice looking vivarium, so I think this is definitely an 8, and I think it's a 9 because once this is a bit more grown in, it's definitely going to look really beautiful. So yeah, I think 8.5 for the last one. I think that's a good note to end on. Yeah, so I haven't, Jay Bean, you haven't written anything more in chat, so I'm assuming you haven't sent something. Yeah, I think it's a bit too late now. Yeah, it was a very interesting stream. Been really fun to see all of your vivariums, to get some inspiration. And if you're watching this live, I definitely hope you had a really good time. And if you're watching the video on YouTube, I hope you found it entertaining and maybe learned something from it. And I think I will probably do this again at some point, so make sure to subscribe so you won't miss out on that. And I think that's about it for the stream or the video, whatever you're watching. Thank you all so much for tuning in. It's been really fun. I wasn't expecting this many of you to actually come and watch. So yeah, really fun. We will definitely do this again at some point if you want to. And take care, everyone. I just have to end stream, which is like a bit cringe when I just said goodbye. Wait, where the heck do I end stream? It's here. Yeah. See you all.